Hey everybody, how's it going? My name is Noah. Before I start today, I just want to have a quick apology. I'm sorry I've been gone for a while, but school's been busy, as most of you probably know. It's a pain in the ass, but that is the exact reason why I am back here today, because today I am talking about something really special. This is actually a project for my gender and communication class, and today I'm going to be discussing the history of women in hip-hop. It's a topic that I think is really important, so I wanted to share it on here as well, but it is going to be a little bit of a doozy, so stick with me, and let's dive right into it. So hip-hop is a genre that I think most people look at as being relatively young. It's about 50 years old, but in that time, it's garnered a huge amount of success and attention. It's done a lot of good. It's given voice to otherwise historically disenfranchised black people, and it's created what I think are some of the best albums of all time. But that's not to say that hip-hop hasn't come without its controversy. Hip-hop has received a lot of flack in the past for being violent and hedonistic, misogynistic, and that last one's really what I want to focus on today. There's a lot of people in the hip-hop community who don't think hip-hop is misogynistic or don't think it's a problem. There are some people who completely and outright detest this, and there are, I think, more people who know this and acknowledge this, but maybe don't do enough to address the problem. And that's really the crowd I want to speak to today. I already know there's probably a section of you who think that women can't rap or aren't going to be as good as rapping or at least never going to be as good as Lauryn Hill, and that's a really great discussion to have, and I really don't have time to get to the ins and outs of that discussion. So for the sake of this video, we're just going to have to go ahead and assume you're wrong. You're just wrong. It's okay to be wrong sometimes, but you're wrong. And who knows, maybe along the way today you'll be convinced otherwise. So I thought it'd be helpful basically to ask ourselves three basic questions today. One, what has the history of hip-hop and women been like? Two, what are some of the greater forces causing that problem? And three, what can we do about it? One aside, I do want to get out of the way now. Most of you are probably already aware of this, but I figured it would be good just to publicly state. Most of the academic literature on this topic is written toward and geared toward black women. I am obviously not a black woman. I am a pretty white man. I think I would be remiss not to mention that. However, I do still hope that I can do a lot of this great literature and study justice. Obviously, I won't be able to talk about all of it today, but I hope to cover as much of it as humanly possible. So, let's go. So, to answer this first question, I thought it'd be good to look at who was the first woman in hip-hop. And depending on how you like to look at things, there's a couple of ways you can slice this. If you're an album junkie like me, you might want to start by going back to the first solo record from a woman in hip-hop. And if you do that, you'd have to go back to 1988 with MC Light's Light as a Rock. All of them, what you say to me is just paper thin. However, if you're a little bit more well-read on your hip-hop history, you would know that hip-hop mostly started as a single genre. So, really, you should probably go back to the first single a solo artist ever put out. And for that, you'd have to go back 8 more years to Lady B's To The Beat, Y'all. But you could actually go back even farther. If you talk to most people in the hip-hop community, or people who even just have a general knowledge of hip-hop, and ask them, what is the beginning of hip-hop, the answer you get often is Sugar Hill Gang. It's not the most accurate answer, but it's definitely a good answer. And if you're saying to yourself, wait a minute, Noah, I know where this is going, you're going to talk about Sylvia Robinson, you are correct. Congratulations, you've seen that episode of Drunk History. If you haven't, one, go watch it. It's a great episode.
Take me to anybody who can rap and rhyme over music. Take me to them.
But two, Sylvia Robinson is actually a writer who helped essentially write and assemble the original Sugar Hill Gang. Sugar Hill Gang would not exist without Sylvia Robinson. And arguably, much of hip-hop would not have existed without Sylvia Robinson. So I think that's important to put out. However, there is one thread tying all three of these acts together, and that is
a lack of resources. If you look at a really great article called Where My Girl's At by Miki Sane and Christina Drumheller, they point out a really big issue for women rapping in the 80s, and that was a lack of resources. Essentially, a lot of women could not afford to buy DJing equipment, which was a huge issue. And if you don't know, speaking from experience,
that shit is expensive.
You have to get yourself turntables, and into the 90s, you'd have to start buying yourself MPCs. It was really only till now that that is even remotely starting to change now with computers. But back then, it was really, really hard to get your hands on studio equipment. And that had a lot of lasting ramifications. That meant that really women in hip-hop were pretty much relegated to rapping at best. They couldn't be producers or audio engineers or label heads down the road. However, there is one great woman who produced back in the 80s that I would be remiss not to mention. I have to talk about one of my absolute favorite acts of the 80s, Salt-N-Pepa, and particularly DJ Spinderella. Of course, responsible for some of the greatest singles ever, like Push It, and one of the most commonly used hip-hop samples of all time.
One, two, my mic sound nice, check one. My mic sound nice, check two. My mic sound nice, check three. Are you ready?
But now this starts guiding us into the 90s. Hip-hop has become a national commodity. Each part of the country has different flavors of hip-hop, and it started seeing a lot of widespread success. And with it, so did the woman in the genre as well. Now, it's not to say that at this point everything was hunky-dory. There was still a lot of issues for women. A lot of the sexualization and objectification started becoming more and more relevant within the genre. But I would argue there's an even more indicative issue beginning to happen. So the first thing that you kind of have to look at in the 90s is how most of these women came up. And that was really through rap cliques, because back in the 90s, everybody wanted to be Wu-Tang Clan. So basically the strategy was add one woman to another act. This was the case for Lauryn Hill in the Fugees, Rod Digga in the Outsiders, Remy Ma in the Terror Squad, Lil' Kim in Junior Mafia, and Gangsta Boo in 3-6 Mafia, plus probably plenty of others that I'm forgetting to mention right now. It wasn't the most progressive way of including women in hip-hop, but it did work at the time, and it did give a lot of women the opportunity to prove that they could rap as good as the men. They put them alongside the men, and a lot of the time they came out winning, especially in the case of Lauryn Hill. Now, one of my favorite examples to show you of this would be Cowboys by the Fugees back in 1996. And Lauryn Hill and Rod Digga absolutely killed it.
Anyone approaches, we like, no, that's buenos. Then I compose a poem for the mini gunslingers, R&B singers, perpetrating guns for two fingers. Is perhaps one of the foulest. I inhale large clouds of smoke through my chalice. Fucking at stars. And write rhymes for hours. The ghetto misty. Yeah. Drinking whiskey.
And it helped a lot. In the late 90s, you started to see a couple more solo acts emerge. Lauryn Hill released one of the greatest hip-hop albums of all time in The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. Missy Elliott was starting to make a huge name for herself, and things were looking up. However, there were two key issues that came about at this point. One, the one thing that helped hip-hop a lot in the 90s finally came to a head, and that was conflict. Hip-hop, in a lot of ways, really does embrace conflict. The entire 90s was framed on an East Coast-West Coast war, as most people know. And the problem with that was, is while that conflict was entertaining, it was unsustainable. Biggie and Pac ended up dying because of their beef. And women started facing a lot of the same issues. Now, for those of you who really aren't in on the hip-hop community, it's probably important to know that there are some important ground rules. For one, it's considered to be unacceptable for men to diss women and children within rap songs. But it is heavily debated. So naturally, a lot of other MCs wouldn't go after female rappers. So they had to go at each other. And it kind of makes sense in a lot of ways, and it led to a lot of really popular tracks back in the 90s. But again, it wasn't sustainable. Back then, a diss track could really fuck up your career pretty bad. And for a lot of women, it did. And it led to really only a few women being left standing by the 2000s. Really, by the late 2000s and 2010s, it was really just Nicki Minaj left in the lead. The other big problem that contributed to this leading into the 2000s was the death of Biggie and Pac. The genre's two biggest voices at the time died, and it kind of left a little bit of a vacuum to be filled. And as that happened, the market share of hip-hop started to shrink. On the note of losing market share into the 2000s, Justin Hunt actually did a great video on this similar topic, and he got the opportunity to interview Rye Digga, where she got to provide some of her perspective.
Same time that that was happening, I feel like labels just really started getting skipped. Like, once all the labels started merging and it really started getting hard for people to sell records, especially I think the one Summer Kim had the real big record, the Put Your Lighters Up, and I don't think it really moved any units. I think at that point, labels really got scared, like, wait a minute. Arguably one of the most successful female hip hop artists, and she's going to jail, is like, you know, can't move any units right now. I think labels really got scared to get behind females at that point.
There was less room for great talents in there, for men and women, but obviously that disproportionately affected women much, much worse. So what happened exactly in the 2000s? Well, bling rap happened. And I'm going to be honest with you.
I don't like bling rap. Most of it's bad. Really bad.
But a lot of people really like it, so I get that. If you don't know what bling rap is, all you really need to know is that it's characterized by materialism. Lots and lots of materialism. See, while hip-hop certainly had a far smaller market share in the 2000s, it still made a ton of money in the 90s, money that a lot of these hip-hop artists hadn't seen before, so they weren't afraid to flash a little bit of it. You had the fat stacks of cash in the videos, the chains, the cars, and the women. Women in hip-hop now, more than ever, really started being relegated to merely sexual objects, which was really nasty. I'm not saying it didn't happen before, I mean 2 Live Crew, but it got really bad in the 90s. Really, the most often you saw women in hip-hop was in a music video. And it became a huge issue. You now had women being routinely objectified in music and didn't have enough room on the mic to provide a counterpoint to that. Nor was there anybody behind the scenes helping shape or change that infrastructure. So it was a really huge issue. And it remained a really big issue throughout most of the 2010s. So now at this point, it might seem natural for me to talk about the 2010s more, but I'm actually going to set that aside for now, and I'm going to actually save that for our third question tonight. And for now, I want to move on to our second question.
That was probably a good time to ask ourselves, why? Why do people suck? And the answer is, it's complicated. In this portion of the video, I am forewarning a lot of you now who maybe aren't predisposed to this sort of thing. There is going to be a lot of gender theory involved, and I know for most of the hip-hop fans out there, this is really not what they signed up for, but please stick with me, close those other tabs, I will make this as quick and painless as possible.
So one of the first things you're going to probably want to have to take a look at when you're talking about gender theory is the idea of hegemony. Hegemony is not only a very fancy word, but it essentially is basically the concept that one group is always controlling another one through power or force, which at first doesn't seem like a lot. I mean, a lot of hip-hop is about power. Look at Kanye West. However, this has much more insidious undertones to it, as this is kind of the framework for every bigoted institution ever. You look at institutional racism, or in this case, institutional sexism. These are essentially the forces that allow that to happen, granting power to one group in order to oppress another. In this case, men over women. And on the note of racism, however, a lot of it does factor in. One amazingly titled article called Go White Girl Go, Hip Hop Booty Dancing and the White Female Body, kind of actually provides context as to why booty dancing is so relevant to hip-hop culture. Spoiler alert, it's racism. It was essentially a means of degrading specifically black women's body, and that puts them at a massive disadvantage. They're already part of a racial minority, and now also a gender with less voice. So how do these institutions stay afloat? Well, another study points to the idea of marketing in hip-hop, which makes a lot of sense. A lot of hip-hop is about marketing. Look at Bling Rap. Rick Ross's label isn't called Expensive Cars Music, it's Maybach Music. Kanye West isn't Pink Polo Joe, he's Louis Vuitton Don. Brands are really important to hip-hop, and their marketing really affects their ability to do things. See, labels are concerned about making money, and at one time in hip-hop, a lot of artists were really just concerned about making it big, which kind of makes sense, you know? If you ask any millennial nowadays what they want to be when they grow up, a good chunk of them are going to tell you they want to be famous. And that was a lot of the same back then. Just ask Cameron.
I just want my record on the radio. I just want to shoot videos.
And get it popping.
I just want to get popping. Look, I don't care. Take my publisher. I don't know what that is anyway. Just, you know what I'm saying? Like, just take my shit so I can have a video and songs on the radio. I'll figure it out later.
That's crazy,
and
then
the next album, I'm like, damn, these checks ain't like the checks that I'm used to niggas seeing. I'm not being able to get 4 and 5 cars or jewelry or things that I want to get. So I'm like, let me figure out what's the loophole in this shit while I'm not winning.
Isn't it crazy that it makes you question what kind of friends you had back then because they weren't telling you how the business was run and they were just...
See, that goes to show maybe they wasn't never really my friends.
So while labels and other companies continued to make money off of black culture, they didn't get a lot of voice in how they wanted to do things. So naturally, those powerful institutions remained unchallenged. Another thing that helped is something called... Now, another thing that helped in creating this issue would be something known as gender performativity. Essentially, for those of you who don't know what this is, performativity is essentially the concept that gender as a whole is a social construct. We allow gender to exist. Gender is roles, it's positions, it's a performance that we all take on and partake in and reinforce through our performances. Which I know for a lot of you either sounds like a bunch of SJW bullshit or something really kind of heady and weird and complicated that might be difficult to wrap your head around. But again, please stick with me here. I promise it's not too scary. Essentially, just think about what makes a man and what makes a woman. For most people, that's going to boil down to things that you have a lot of control over. And it might not seem like you have a lot of control over that because it's so culturally and psychologically embedded into our society. Which kind of makes sense. And that leads us to how it affected hip-hop through what's also known as two culture theory. The idea that men and women are... It's the idea that essentially men and women are so inherently different, they really should be known by two different cultures, which is pretty extreme. And a lot of gender theorists would totally not merit a lot of license to this idea. But in hip-hop, it kind of makes sense. Two culture theory essentially plays on the idea that men subscribe to an idea called report talk. Report talk is about getting objectives done. It's about achievement, success. Men like talking about beer and women and fast cars. And guess what? They like talking about those things in hip hop. Now, women, on the other hand, like something what's known as report talk. This is the idea of building relationships and maintaining them, talking about your feelings. Pretty stereotypically gendered ideas, but a lot of those are maintained through hip-hop, and I would argue that part of the reason that is because of the way men talk about hip-hop. Now, the way men talk about women in hip-hop has been something that I've really haven't touched on a lot in this video, and that's mostly because I think we are all already have a pretty decent idea how that works, but I wanted to illustrate one specific example, because I've listened to, I think, my fair share of hip-hop records now, and when thinking about how artists refer to women, I can think of 4 different relationships women are referred to when spoken about by men. Mothers, daughters, lovers or wives, and sexual objects. Now, the first 3 aren't really harmful at all. Most of the time, they're really good and can lead to perfectly fine music. And obviously the latter is much, much more harmful. But when you look at it, it's still kind of frustrating because it still only means that men will refer to women in hip-hop only by relation to them. One of the fewest examples I see is something like universal sisterhood, which is odd considering universal brotherhood is such a prevalent concept in hip-hop, the idea of one unified race. But it just doesn't seem that often that that same hand is extended to women in hip-hop. Now, I should mention that attitude is very much beginning to change. Slowly, but it is. But if you guys aren't completely understanding what I'm saying, I like to point your direction now back to Kanye, because Kanye is a great example of this, as he has checked all four boxes in this section. And sometimes even on one or two records, if you want to hear Kanye talk about his mother, you could listen to the closing track on 808s and Heartbreaks or Roses off of Late Registration. Memories made in the coldest winter. If you want to hear him talk about his relationship with Kim, you could listen to Bound 2 off Yeezus or Never Leave off of Ye. Now you testing our loyalty. This is what they mean when they say for better or for worse, huh? For every damn female that stuck with they dude through the best times, through the worst times. Just for you. Man, I know you wouldn't leave. If you want to hear Kanye talk about his daughters, you could listen to Violent Crimes. I'm scared of the karma, cause now I see women as something to nurture, not something to conquer. I hope she like Nicki, I'll make her a monster. And if you want to hear Kanye talk about sex, you could literally listen to the rest of Yeezus or All Mine, or multiple tracks off The Life of Pablo, or multiple tracks off of The College Dropout. Really, you got like a 50-50 shot of pulling a song about sex with Kanye. So, I think it's pretty clear to say that a lot of these institutions that keep allowing this routine sexism is deeply, deeply embedded into hip-hop and greater Western culture. This is not a problem that hip-hop faces alone, but that doesn't mean hip-hop isn't responsible for its fair share of the issue. So now I think it's time to work to part three of this video. So what can we do right now? Well, this is kind of where the end of part one kind of comes back into the 2010s, because good news is there's already a lot being done. It seems like a lot of the old heads are kind of starting to come around on a lot of these issues, even if maybe their motivations for doing so aren't completely progressive or complete in a lot of ways. Another thing to consider with these older artists is as they've grown older, so has a lot of their content. Sure, a lot of artists are going to remain behind the curve, but as long as we keep pushing them to grow and reflect in their older age, a lot of them are probably gonna learn and understand new things. Even if that change and that growth seems slow, it at least seems like a lot of artists are putting in the effort. One, I think that's definitely worth a lot of praise and credit is a guy like Jay-Z, who came back a couple years ago to essentially make a record apologizing to Beyonce for his infidelity. I apologize, orphan woman eyes, took for my child to be born, see through a woman's eyes, took for these natural twins to believe in miracles, took me too long for this song, I don't deserve you, I harass you out in Paris, please come back to Rome, you make it home, we talked for hours when you were on. It was a record that was really revealing for Jay-Z, and for a lot of people who might not have been complete Jay-Z fans before, certainly gave a new perspective, and that should also continue to be encouraged throughout the genre. And a lot of the younger kids right now getting involved in hip-hop are using the internet as an equalizer. Platforms like SoundCloud allow anybody to upload music, and it helps women. All you need nowadays to make a record really is a laptop and a DAW. And that helps. Most men and women have access to a computer. And getting a DAW nowadays is pretty easy. You can usually get one anywhere from free to maybe a couple $100. But still, there's a lot of work to be done. So let's examine a few ways that we could better this problem. The first one is there really does need to be a massive culture change in hip-hop. And this is where that discussion about whether or not women can rap has to come back. Because again, they can rap. They are more than capable of rapping. If you don't believe me, go back and listen to a number of records. If you like 90s conscious hip hop, go ahead and listen to Queen Latifah. If you like angry SoundCloud Raiders, go ahead and listen to Rico Nasty. Like Rico. if you like fun, weird hipster hip hop, go ahead and listen to somebody like No Name or Samus. Really, I could go on for days because, again, women can rap. It's important to remember that hip hop is a culture, and that's kind of what I love about it. Hip hop is, I think, more capable of self-examination than nearly any other genre of music. And now is a really important time to have some serious self-examination. Hip-hop has an opportunity to really better itself right now, and we should take advantage of that. So another thing that's going to have to happen then is change in the infrastructure of hip-hop. Now, the internet already, again, plays a role in this, as it kind of destabilizes a lot of that. But labels still exist, and labels are going to continue consolidating, as Radega pointed out earlier. And that means that women are going to have to be provided more opportunities to play more roles, both in terms of depth and breadth as well. I'm talking producers, label executives, management. These roles are important. But I know you're probably saying at home, Noah, I can't do that. I don't own a label. What else can I do? And that leads to the simplest solution, supporting more artists. And this is really the part of the video that I'm excited for, because this is basically where I just get to hit you with like a bunch of amazing rappers. Again, I already name drop people like No Name and Samus. Little Simz is definitely in there. By the way, Little Simz has right now like the best album of the year. And it doesn't seem like a lot, but I would argue it plays a big role. Part of the reason why we ran into this issue in the 90s is because people stopped supporting female artists. And right now, if we continue to support them, things are going to keep working out. Hip hop is a global commodity right now, and it's being picked up everywhere. That's evident by people like Billie Eilish and Ariana Grande, who are picking up mics and dropping bars. Even if they are kind of not totally co-signed 100% by old heads, it's still important. As long as hip-hop stays popular right now, it can use its platform to redesign and reshape its values in a really important way. And we all need to be a part of that. So again, I've already started naming some artists that I think are really worth checking out. Right now, I'm going to just throw up a list on the screen of even more artists that I think are great and worth checking out. These aren't all the artists that are worth checking out, but these are at least some that you should at least be aware of.
So I think that about does it for now, guys. Please, again, go check out these artists. They're great. They are definitely deserving of your attention and are going to continue to do great things as long as we continue to support them. So please go check them out. Thank you for watching. Again, I'm sorry I couldn't cover everything in this video. Hopefully in the future I can maybe do a follow-up on this, cover some more aspects of this issue, or even other issues if that's something that you guys are interested in. But yeah, continue to support great artists and like have a great fucking day.